Hi, everyone. Welcome to our very first meetup. I'm not an embattled speaker, as you can tell, so I don't know how to work the mic. Hopefully, I figure it out throughout the presentation. I don't want to steal too much time from our great speakers. Just a quick introduction to organize this meetup along with my colleague Joe da Silva, which stands over there, and a few supporters here in Avast. So we started this meetup just out of a mere interest. We basically, our daily job is JVM based languages and functional programming, and we thought that it's a good idea to add a new meetup to the Prague's thriving development community and share ideas and learn and share experiences together with the other developers from other companies. So that's basically the motivation behind this. Our objective at the moment is pretty much very basic, so we just wanted to get space for knowledge sharing. We try to focus on functional programming and JVM technologies. That's the plan. This is our very first talk, which revolves around GraalVM, and let's see how it goes, how it unfolds throughout the year. So obviously we are open to new ideas. So if you have your very own idea of about a lightning talk or even a longer presentation, please get in touch. I'm sure that we have our deal and the stage is pretty much granted to be yours. Before I start, I would like to say big thanks to Avast, who sponsors this event and the meetup in general. So thanks for that. And now, as I said, the presentations today will revolve around GraalVM, which I'm sure most of you know is a high-performance universal virtual machine. GraalVM is also referred to as a polyglot virtual machine because it's suitable for running applications written in many different languages. The obvious ones are JVM-based, Java, Scala, Kotlin, or Clojure, over to support of C or C++. It's also possible to embed dynamic languages like JavaScript, Python, Ruby, or R into GraalVM. And I'm excited to say that, and Scala, sorry, how could I have forgotten Scala? Sorry about that. So I'm pleased to say that today's presentation will not be about Scala, not about JVM, but more about GraalVM and dynamic languages. So our presentations will focus on JavaScript and R. So with that said, let me welcome our first speaker on stage, Jaroslav Tulach from Oracle Labs. So I'm not sure if it makes any sense to try to introduce Jaroslav, but let me like repeat again. So Jaroslav of several books on API design of better
Thank you. Okay, the mic works. How should I start? So anyway, the important stuff. Does anyone has a Twitter account? You will be need to prove that I was here. And the best way to do that is to show all the tweets, or at least one.
Sorry to interrupt. I forgot to mention, obviously, this meetup also has a Twitter handle. It's functional_JVM. Tweet there first. Thank you.
Yeah, one tweet, put it together, one handle, one hashtag, and everyone will be happy. Okay. So, I'm not going to talk about Scala, that has already been announced. What I'm going to talk about? Does anyone of you use JDK 11? Oh, phew, perfect. No, smooth, perfect, okay. Yeah, it's not undoable, but there are some surprises, and I'm going to talk about one, which is that Nashorn got deprecated. Anybody is using JavaScript on the JVM? Okay, that's the talk that will suit you. Okay, so this Nashorn is actually implementation of JavaScript engine that runs on top of JVM. And now the sad news is that it has been deprecated. You may want to freak out. Actually, you don't because you don't use it, but some people do. Okay. Mm-hmm. Interesting. My computer is still fine. Something is visible there for every 5 seconds. No, it's gone. Now it's there. And now it's gone. No. Well, it's true that I touched the computer.
Mm-hmm. So the connector is in good condition.
Before we get the issue fixed, could raise your hand if you're not from Avast? This is just a quick research, just to get an idea. Okay. Excellent. You're not. Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you.
No, není kam to dát. Mám jenom ten jeden konektor. A nebo VGA můžeme zkusit. Ale to nebude mít to správné rozlišení. No, tak já budu pokračovat. Jednou se mně stalo něco podobného. Přišel jsem na EclipseCon jako reprezentovat NetBeans a chtěl jsem přednášet o nejrychlejším OSGI kontejneru na světě, což samozřejmě jsou NetBeans. A bohužel jsem neměl čas se nějak připravit na to, aby mi fungoval projektor. A takže jsem to všechno musel přednášet z paměti a úplně nejlepší bylo, když jsem dělal demo. A říkal jsem, podívejte, teď tady kliknu, startuje pomalu, teď to pustím v módu toho NetBinoxu a teď to startuje rychle. Takže to byl takový rozhlasová reportáž. No, anyway, let's continue with the slides, without the slides. As has been mentioned a long time ago, I founded NetBeans, and I was also architecting them, and I like to say that over the time I made so many design mistakes that I felt obligated to write a book about that. The book is called Practical API Design, and it's a fantastic book. Everyone should read it, of course. But the more important thing than having the book selling well was to actually attract attention of Oracle Labs. Oracle Labs wanted to design Truffle and Graal APIs, and they actually hired me to help them with that. So that's the reason I ended up in Oracle Labs. And now I need the most important slide.
No.
Tak jiný konektor, tenhle.
To není ono. To je prostě chyba v tom konektoru, v tom notebooku.
V notebooku není žádná chyba. Notebook normálně funguje, ráno fungoval. Můžu to restartovat. A nebo to...
Funguje.
To se stává. Slidy se poslat dají, ale bohužel jsou to jenom dema.
Že bych to přesvědčil?
Nechci. Musí to fungovat. Jinak to nepůjde.
20 prezentace.
No, ale jsem nic. Obrazovky.
No, ale to nemůžu, to musíte až takové hodně daleko. No, to nemůžu. Tohle to třeba no. Ještě potom ta frekvence o tom ještě, ale to jo.
No, OK.
Pustám ještě dobrý.
Let's try different resolution. But at least we know what could be the fix. Yeah, this is okay. Okay, let's try this one. Yep. And Oracle Apps is not Oracle. It's just a part of Oracle. Still, we are obligated to show you this slide. So please be warned. And this is why I needed the projector. Because you have to see the slide. And then, I have another slide with agenda, and I will talk about JDK 11, I will talk about GraalJS, tooling, and Node.js, which could be interesting things, and the rest of the presentation is basically just a demo. And that's the reason I could not accept the offer to do the presentation from a different computer. Demo, replacing Nashorn with GraalJS. So, in case you'd be using JavaScript on JVM, you could be sort of surprised and felt sort of uneasy by announcement made as a Java enhancement process. Enhancement process to actually deprecate Nashorn JavaScript engine and schedule it for removal. So this has happened between JDK 10 and JDK 11. Nashorn's JavaScript engine is still there, but it is deprecated. And if you try to use it, it will print into the console warnings saying this is scheduled to be deprecated. So certain communities, certain projects were actually looking for alternative. And this also happened inside of the NetBeans community. NetBeans has been donated by Oracle to Apache, and NetBeans found relatively good home there with a lot of people taking care of that project and being outside of Oracle. So, when they saw this, they actually started to think about what shall the project do? How shall we replace Nashorn? And the whole thing got really accelerated in November last year when we found it out, or there has been the CVE report, Security Vulnerability Report against NetBeans, that actually somebody can hack in NetBeans by properly misconfiguring the system, the proxy in the network. So the community started to think about that, and they decided that Nashorn is the core source of the problems, which is sort of true, because in case of Nashorn, people were, well, in general, when you try to balance security and ease of use, they go against each other. If you simplify ease of use, you will probably give up something on the security. And if you tighten security, it's not going to be easy to use. So Nashorn was designed to be easy to use, and security is afterthought. And because NetBeans were using Nashorn to, for example, parse proxy configuration scripts. Thank you, Irka, for the work. The Nashorn was not really suitable for that because people could hack in through that. So the replacement, the community was seeking for replacement, and the first idea was to put their Rhino. Rhino is old Mozilla implementation of JavaScript in Java, and it's designed to be more secure. So the community would manage to fix that. But on the other hand, we in Oracle Labs are working on modern re-implementation of JavaScript engines. NetBeans, fighting GraalJS. So instead of Nashorn, you can actually use GraalJS. GraalJS is source code is available on GitHub. It is fully open sourced. It's a regular Java re-implementation of JavaScript. And not only that, it also contains re-implementation of Node.js. But I'll leave that for later. So how complicated is actually to use GraalJS? Well, fairly easy. If you don't mind downloading GraalVM. GraalVM is basically the Oracle Labs offer of a polyglot Java virtual machine. So Java 8 compatible virtual machine, which in addition to that provides features like speed up, especially for Scala programs, and it's polyglot. So not only that it supports Java, but inherently it also supports JavaScript, R, Zbyněk will talk about that later, Ruby, Python, something more, other different languages. LLVM, yeah, LLVM. So, okay, so you can download GraalVM. There are two options. You can choose from Community Edition and Enterprise Edition. Community Edition is fully open sourced, so soon your favorite Linux distribution should have it as a package. Enterprise Edition can be downloaded from Oracle Technology Network. So for that, you need to trust Oracle and register with Oracle. Some people do, some people don't. Anyway, the original purpose of this talk was not to talk about GraalVM, but to talk about JDK 11. And as such, we don't want to start from this road. We want to take a completely different one. We want to start downloading regular JDK 11. JDK 11 is available on jdkjava.net. You can download it, install it. And once you have it, I'd like you to visit this page, another project on GitHub called GraalJS JDK 11 Maven Demo. And that's a project that will help you get started, will help you install GraalJS and use it as a replacement for Nashorn. Okay, let's check it out. I already have done that. So if you do it, you will see a Maven application. You can open the Maven application in your favorite IDE. And it contains two source files, application and tests. Okay, the application itself. It's a regular Java class. Inside of that is a JavaScript source. So this is a source file. Actually, it's going to compute prime numbers. And the application is ready for benchmarking. Let me make it bigger. Last one. And also 11. But you can also run the same script with Graal script engine. GraalJS provides its re-implementation of JavaScript engine. Guys, do you know what is Java script engine? Java X script engine? One? Too little, okay. I think it happened in JDK 6. The JDK decided to add an API for integrating scripting languages. And it is located inside of JavaX script package that contains various classes. The most important one, or the good entry point, is Script Engine Manager and Script Engine. So let me jump here. In case you want to execute your script, what you can do is to instantiate the Script Engine Manager, get engine by name or by a MIME type, if you know the MIME type, and once you have it, you can actually invoke evaluate sources. So that's done here. So you can call eval, and that will basically interpret or compile the source of the, in this case, JavaScript, run it inside of the JVM and give you the result. So actually what we have here is a benchmark. Well, I guess that's enough for the introduction, and it's time to execute the code. So first of all, we will run the code with JavaScript with Nashorn, which is the default engine. It computes the prime numbers, and it takes 200 milliseconds. And the rest of the tests has been skipped because I have done something in the wrong way. Properties, compile. Okay, I'm running on JDK 8. Let's run on JDK 11 and run the same test again. So Maven project starting, now warming up the JavaScript engine. The speed is the same. That implies there has not been that much work between JDK and JDK 11 on Nashorn. And now running the same script with GraalJS. And as you can see, the result is slightly faster. Instead of 250 milliseconds, we can get below 150 milliseconds. So that's the usual speed up you can get by using GraalJS. In many workloads, GraalJS is faster. But the drawback is it needs a little bit more time to warm up. Initially, the interpretation is slower. Only after a while, for a longer running processes, it speeds up and can outperform engine. Org GraalVM Polyglot, which is the API that we prefer our users to use, because then they have more type safe and more direct access to various features of the Polyglot implementation. And the Polyglot basically means that you can talk with this API, with the Polyglot API, you can execute JavaScript, but you can also execute Ruby, Python, R. Zbyněk will talk about that. Interop side of our story later. Okay, so that was the demo. replacing Nashorn with Graal.js on JDK 11. Maybe not. Maybe I haven't mentioned everything. The important part are is hidden dependencies. So actually, what you need to do is you need to set up your Java virtual machine properly. So first of all, you need Graal SDK and JavaScript engine to be available for compilation. And then you can use the Polyglot API, then you can talk to the script engine. And in addition to that, you actually need a JavaScript engine, which is this artifact. The rest are dependencies, which are not that important. But another important thing is, if you want to run fast, you actually need to, let me increase the font again. Oops. Aha, jasně. What you actually need to do is to specify this command line. When you start Java, you need to tell the Java virtual machine to use the Graal compiler. Graal compiler is an alternative to C2 compiler, which is inside of not C++ code, it's written in Java. And because it's written in Java, you can actually, or you get it inside of a jar file. And the only thing that you need to do is to tell the Java virtual machine to use that jar file instead of C2, which you do by saying enable JVM CI and use the JVM CI compiler, I think. And then you need to put the jar file on a class path. So this is all you need to do if you want to use Graal and Graal.js or any other language based on Graal.js inside of your Java application. Just set up the class path and specify the compiler. By the way, do you have any questions? No?
Yeah, maybe I have a question.
Perfect, question is good.
I think I noticed that you showed us three ways. Oh, yeah. Thank you. I have a...
showed us three ways how to run JavaScript, one old one and two new ones, right? And I think those two ones were different, so like performance-wise. Why is that? One was the script engine, the old, like new engine via the old way, and one just the straight polyglot modern way.
So I showed you three different ways how to run the script, the JavaScript script. One was using the Nashorn engine here.
That's slow, yes.
And that's the slow one. And the two other are given here. One is using the context, the special API. One is using the script engine. And they are basically the same. At the end, they end up somewhere at 150, 140 milliseconds. The difference that you see between the initial numbers and the end numbers is going to be caused by the fact that this is running later. So the engine is already warm up more because it shares the same Graal.js implementation, just the facade, the API to access it is different. And also, so basically that's the explanation why the times are different. But what can we do? Let's prove that I'm right. Let's see if I can do it. So it's in the test. Graal polyglot speed, Graal script engine speed. So let's revert the order and let's hope that JUnit will preserve the order. So Nashorn should be first. That's true. If I made the change, no, it's still context. What can we do? And script engine. So the result is the same. Okay, that's not what I wanted. So let's try this one. Okay, so now I should be able to control the order. So, first of all, no, I have to twice the same one. Nashorn benchmark, aha. Nashorn benchmark is the first one. So, we want the script engine to be sooner than the polyglot one. Let's try now. So that's the Nashorn, which is done in the class warmup. Now the script engine, which will probably not be as fast. And now? Sort of.
Yeah, I can see it there. Thanks.
Sort of. Unexplainable difference. Well, as far as I know, the script engine is implemented by delegating to the context API. So it really should not be faster. But the variants may differ.
Thank you. OK, so you showed us the way how we can run JavaScript or any other language which is written by Trafo. That any language which is written using Trafo API, so it can be run in JDK 11.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so my question is, why do we need GraalVM?
Okay, so...
I know that one reason is creating native images, for example.
That's true, okay.
Okay, but what are the others?
So the core of the question is why do we need GraalVM when we can do similar things with JDK 11? Or is one of those things better than the other? The thing is that in Oracle Labs, we are trying to make this a product. And GraalVM is the product that we can offer you as a consumer and customer that you can actually buy from Oracle. So if you want to buy something from Oracle, well, GraalVM would be our offer. On the other hand, the whole project is open source. So you can take individual pieces and assemble it together. And that's actually what I was demonstrating here, that basically you don't need GraalVM at all. You will get the same performance, the same benefits if you assemble the class path properly and configure the parameters of JDK 11. So that's the explanation. And one more comment about the native image. Yes, that's true. If you want to use native image, you need to run that on JDK 8, which, and of course our offer is to do it with GraalVM. On the other hand, we are also working on porting the native image to JDK 11. So the ultimate goal, we hopefully reach it in November, plus minus 18 months. And the ultimate goal should be to basically be able to run native image on stock JDK 11 or future JDK, the same way how I'm demonstrating the Graal.js. But right now it's restricted to JDK 8, basically GraalVM.
Will it ever be part of JDK?
Will native image ever be part of JDK? You have seen the slide. Safe harbor statement. I can say anything you, and I can lie. I don't know. I doubt. It may, but actually, well, the different part of the, or different answer to this question is, so what we are trying to do is to offer Graal compiler as a standard compiler to the JDK team. And one thing they told us is that if we give them just the jar file, it has drawbacks. And one of the drawbacks is that it bootups, that it needs time to warm up. So first of all, you start up your Java program, then you interpret your code, and you need to compile it. But you don't have the compiler. Compiler is also written in Java. So you need to first compile the compiler, and then you can compile your user code, which takes up to 5 seconds, let's say. So first 6 seconds, the JVM circle, but the thing is that it's not use native image to compile it into, and then we can tell JVM to use succeed on getting this into the JDK, and if we succeed, then this, basically the result of native image will be part of JDK, which means that part of the things that we do are moving to the JDK. The native image utility, I don't know any plans about that, but certainly like this compiler should be there soon. That's all I know and can say.
Thank you for a detailed explanation. There's space for one more question. Any more questions? Anyone?
If there are no more questions, I will have to talk about debugging. Who likes to debug? Anyone? Okay, few. Tak. Okay, so debugging. I already created a few breakpoints here. So what I'm actually going to debug? Well, I'm going to debug the Maven project. Right click, debug. Let's try.
Right, so I think it's about 10 minutes.
10 minutes?
Is that?
Let's do debugging quickly. So,
Perfect. The
nice thing on Truffle GraalVM is that it not only gives you all the languages, not the dynamic languages, but also it gives you tools. And the tools are unified. So here is an example of debugger. So, the debugger understands Java, but it also has extensions for Truffle. So, it understands what it means to create a context. Context is the execution environment for the dynamic languages. And NetBeans has a special plugin, NetBeans 11, or actually NetBeans 10, as well as soon to be released NetBeans 11, contains a special debugger extension which understands this context. So it's all centered around this button, and it's disabled because we don't have any script context yet. But I am going to continue, and now the breakpoint stops when the context is already created. Is it created? Okay, it's created. And you can see that the button got enabled. And what it means, it says, well, put a breakpoint into the first line of a dynamic script. So I am going to continue. And now, instead of Java, I'm going to end up in JavaScript. And it's happening inside of the dynamic languages. The IDE has no knowledge. R Ruby, or and I actually tried Pascal. So if I implement one of these languages, I will get debugger for free. You can see that the stack is also mixed. So I see Java, I see JavaScript. So let me switch the stack into Java. So now I'm looking at the Java view. And you can see that the stack slightly expanded. And this is a signal that the whole interpreter is actually written in Java. But that's good, because you can inspect it. So if you want, you can actually take a look at the Java implementation of your interpreter and debug what it is doing. Of course, this is low-level view. You don't want to take it all the time. But if you are curious to know what it's doing, you can easily switch to the Java view. And when you are tired of that, we can click this icon again and continue. And instead of Java, we will be back in JavaScript. It will stop at the first element in JavaScript. And of course, in JavaScript, breakpoints work, everything works. So that's debugging. Questions? That is a question.
Hello, thank you. First warning, maybe it's a stupid question. I have two questions. First is, what is the motivation to use this thing finally? Because from my point of view, if I want to do something in JavaScript in front-end, Angular, or React, or something like that, so is there any motivation to do this thing?
Okay, so motivation. It may take some time, and I need to skip to another demo, which is actually ECMAScript standards. Let's skip them, but using, actually, using Node.js. So, what actually you can do is to, if you are, well, most of that is server-side, so Angular on a client is not that useful. But people who run some JavaScript on a client often run JavaScript on a server as well. For that, they use Node. And what actually we have is, oops, where is it? Is a Node implementation. Oops. Yeah, so what we did is we took the Node sources and instead of V8, we put there the implementation of our JavaScript, the Graal.js. And as a result of that, I should be able to easily mix JavaScript and Java on a server. Yeah, I should be. But temp. If I found it, demo, Graal.js demo, that's it. Let's hope. No, let's try this one. Open project. Okay, so this should be it. So, it looks like Node.js, you have you basically have your we have HTTP server written in Node.js using the Node.js API, but also in the middle of that we are mixing in various Java functions. So here I'm actually loading a Java type and talking to Java. So in case you have a need to actually do polyglot programming between JavaScript and Java, this actually could be useful because the interop between Java and truffle languages is very smooth. So that might answer your first question.
Thank you. Does that answer your question? Do you need any more? Okay. Thank you.
And you mentioned adding Haskell for your playing. How difficult is it is to introduce a new language to all this? Are you able to use LLVM, interoperability, or whatever?
How difficult it is to introduce new language? Well, that's a perfect question. This semester I'm teaching a course at Matfis about truffle, and I spent 3 lectures explaining the truffle basics, and now I'm going to demonstrate how easy it is to introduce a language. And honestly, the worst part is to write a parser. So if you can write a parser, then you build an AST tree, you are basically done, because all the languages that all the truffle languages are basically written. When you look at the implementation, it's basically an AST tree and interpreter through the AST tree, and that's all. So it's fairly easy. It's as easy as to write interpreter.
Okay, thank you very much. I think there is no more time left for further questions. Feel free to get in touch with Jaroslav, and thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, I'll be around in case you want to ask about something. Just stop by, and I'll try to answer something.
Thank you, Jaroslav.
Thank you.
I think it was a great talk, and it's also a lot of information to digest, so let's just take a short break, let's say 5 to 10 minutes, and then we start our next talk, okay? Thank you. Just a test, test, test. Okay, sorry. Just a quick note. We noticed we're running low on food, so we are ordering more. So there's more pizza to come, basically. So we're ordering pizza, and there will be more food soon. So apologies for that. Okay, so let's slowly ease into the next talk. So some of you might remember him as a former Avastian. Now Zbyněk is with Oracle Labs, and his domain are high-performance streaming applications. And in terms of development for Graal, Zbyněk has been focusing on the project called Truffle.
FastR. But the Truffle is used to implement FastR.
I see, yeah. So yeah. I was just about to say that you basically contributed to the Truffle project, which aims at creating the ability to create languages. Thank you very much. And
yes, okay. So I'm also obliged to do the same thing. So, a minute of silence. And as you may know, today is Fool's Day. And so I feel obliged to make this statement. This presentation contains no Fool's Day allusions or concealed meaning. So take it seriously. Okay, so let me give you the overview of the agenda of this presentation. So first of all, I will give you some quick introduction to GraalVM. So continue language itself. Continue. Language itself. And then after this overview section, I will jump into the main topic of this presentation, which is the using R packages in Java. Because R language itself is a huge source of high quality packages with broad range of application. And it will be followed by the conclusion and question and answers session. So this is a high-level picture, often presented when giving some overview of GraalVM. So what is GraalVM? Jarda already said that it is actually an execution, universal execution environment by which you can execute programs written in various languages. These languages can be dynamic languages like JavaScript, Ruby, of course R, Python, LLVM, and also languages and JVM-based languages like Java, Scala, Kotlin, Clojure, and so on. And what's important, you can use the programs written in those languages in various contexts, like in OpenJDK, in Node.js, in Oracle Database, in MySQL, and also you can run those applications as a standalone applications, which is also important. Okay, so let me introduce GraalVM in this 10-step synopsis, which is based on a very comprehensive article written by Chris Seaton, which is available on this link. And by the way, Chris Seaton is the language team of the Ruby team. So first, high-performance modern Java. Probably the most important component of GraalVM is the Graal compiler. And it is a multi-purpose compiler. It means that it can serve many applications. And one of this role which can be played by compiler is just-in-time compilation. So the technology behind the Graal compiler brings a number of a number of optimizations that weren't available in the other versions of just-in-time compiler. So this just-in-time compiler makes your Java applications faster and also having a smaller footprint, memory footprint. The second step, low footprint, fast startup Java. You may know that Java applications perform best when being run as long-running applications, but they may suffer from long startup times. And this limitation can be tackled by the Graal compiler using the ahead of time compilation, low memory. Python and R. So, as I have already said, GraalVM is a polyglot engine, so you can write your programs in all those languages, but not only write individual programs written in this language, but you can also make those programs to interoperate among themselves. So you can call, for example, from JavaScript, some Ruby function without any friction at all. And also, because it is all these languages are written using the Truffle framework, you can use the power of the Graal compiler themselves. So, for example, the just-in-time on JVM, it is the LLVM, the LLVM language. For you who do not know much about this language, LLVM can be seen as a like high-level or almost high-level assembler, but it is not aimed at programmers, so probably nobody will write programs that directly in LLVM. But there is a broad set of tools or compilers that can be used, for example, for compiling C or C++ code or Fortran code into the LLVM code. And then at this LLVM code you can run on GraalVM, just as JavaScript, Java, Ruby, and other GraalVM languages. So, for example, I'm going to present FastR, which is the R implementation in GraalVM. So one of the usages of LLVM could be that you have a Fortran utility or Fortran Fortran procedure, which you would like to run with FastR and utilize the algorithm implemented by that Fortran code in your R code. So it's quite easy to take this LLVM. So you will just take the Fortran code, and you use, for example, there is a GCC plugin called Dragon Egg, which can convert the fast the Fortran code to the LLVM code. So then you will just grab the LLVM code, and you can load it to your FastR application, and you can work with it as if it were a normal function. Step five, tools that work across all languages. It's also a consequence of the fact that all the languages are implemented using the Truffle framework. So it means that by using this unified layer or unified framework, we can also create, develop a unified set of development tools like IDE, debugger, profiler, and so on. Jarda have already showed the usage of debugger. So, the step number six, extend a JVM-based application. It's basically an embedding of a script or of a program written in one of those languages into Java. So it is actually the application of the polyglot API. Jarda has already talked about it. The step number seven, extend a native application. GraalVM already contains a bundled native dynamic library, which can be linked to a standard non-native application. So you can have, for example, some C program, and you can link this C program with that dynamic library. And then you can use the GraalVM or the potential of the GraalVM from that C program. And the important thing is that that dynamic library has no links to the JVM actually. So it's a self-contained code as a native library. You can write a Java code, your Java application, and let the ahead of time compiler to compile that Java code into a native code. And what you can get is not only a standard application, but the result of this compiler can be, for example, a dynamic library. So you just write some Java library or Java kind of library, and you can let it compile to by the ahead of time compiler, and you will get like DLL or something like dynamically loadable library. Step number nine, polyglot in the database. This is one very obvious application of this feature, and this, for example, in both places, in the front end and also in the database, because it's the same language and Oracle database, which includes this, the GraalVM, can run also that JavaScript code. And the step number 10, create your own language. This is the ultimate goal which you can have or reach. And Jarda has already talked about it. And there was a question about how difficult it is to write your language. I think that learning Truffle language can be quite easy. You do not need some special knowledge, but the problematic part is really building or creating the parser. Yes. My experience is that, for example, the R parser is a very complicated thing. Although the basic idea of the R language is that everything is almost like the function, but in the end, there are so many specific features of the R language that they made the R parser very, very, very complex, very complicated. But definitely, if you learn it, you will be able to create quickly some DS domain-specific languages and so on. It's perfect for those things, domain-specific languages. So now I'm going to present the R part of this presentation. So what's R? R is actually a rather old language. It was conceived in the 70s at Bell's Labs, and the primary target group of this language were statisticians. But today it is widely used mainly. It wasn't R, it was the S language. And it was actually re-implemented S. So a strange development. From the theoretical points of view, the R language combines functional and imperative programming. I think that it was inspired by the scheme language, I would say, I think. And it is known for producing high publication quality graphs. So, but also, it contains a huge repository of high quality code. This is actually the primary point of this demonstration of this presentation. The packages. It is the real power of the R language. The CRAN repository. CRAN. It is actually an acronym for Common R Archive Network, something like that. And it contains almost 14,000 packages. Of course, not all of them are of perfect quality, but there is a like substantial part of it. It is really reliable and nicely written code. There is also an IDE for R. It's called R Studio. Okay, now what's FastR? You probably know what's FastR. FastR is an implementation of the R language in GraalVM. Although it is quite advanced, we must admit that it is still in the experimental stage. And the reason why it is still in the experimental stage, there are many issues, many causes. One of the causes is that the number of those packages. So, and also the variability and the number of degrees of freedom of the R language itself. So it's, although at first sight you could say that it's quite simple, but if you dive into the interior of the implementation, it is really a complicated language. And also, I think that the main role in this complication plays the fact that it's been developed for so long time. So it started in the 70s, so during that time there have been many additions and changes in the concept of the language. And if you look into the RC code, actually the C code implementing the R language, it is really an adventure, I would say. it's really a difficult code to understand. But nevertheless, I think that we have advanced quite a lot, and it's quite usable. I mean, FastR. So, but nevertheless, the aims of the project is to be efficient, which means to use fully the power of the Graal compiler, to be polyglot, to allow cooperation with other languages, to be compatible. It's really the most difficult task, the compatibility, because we aim to be compatible with almost all the packages being offered in the CRAN repository. Embeddable, which means that you can run R scripts or R programs in, for example, in Java. And the important thing, it is licensed in the GPL version 3. Because we have to, we inherited actually this GPL license from the R implementation itself, from the GNU R, which is GNU R is the primary implementation of the R language, and it is distributed in the GPL. And we are reusing some code from it, so this is why we have to distribute it in this license. Okay. So now we are going to use FastR. So using FastR is quite simple. It is very similar to what Jarda has taught about JavaScript. So just to start playing with GraalVM, you will have to download the GraalVM from this address. And you will just export path, environment variable which will have to point to the home directory of this unpacked tarball. And then when the GraalVM is on your path, you can install the R language. And the installation is pretty straightforward. You will just use this GU utility. It is Graal, I think. Graal U is, what does U mean? I don't exactly. Okay. Utility probably, Graal utility probably. And install R, and so GU install R, it is everything what you need if you want to install R and start playing with it. And then you will just type R, and the R will launch. So now I would like to switch to the R console. Yes, it works perfectly. So, but I will quit the session and restart it in order to show you a typical pattern of using FastR with focus on improving the performance. So let's start the R language. So this is the standalone version of R. You can also embed it, for example, but this is the standalone illustration. So one of the common functions is the random number generator. So run a function, it generates, for example, in this case, it will generate 10 random numbers. But let's generate a bigger number of numbers, like 10 millions. 10. And also we will measure the time spent by this operation system. Okay, so it took like three seconds and something more. If we repeat the same command, we will get almost the same time. And now we see that the time has dwindled. It reduced quite significantly now, because what was going here that some part of this command, this function, got compiled. So now we are running the code mostly in the compiled code. It could improve even more, I think. Not. Oh, I think it so now how to embed an R script into your Java application. So you will use Graal Polyglot API, which is actually a gate through which you can communicate with GraalVM. So it's just about creating a new context. Context is a very, very common concept in GraalVM. A context is actually the representation of the GraalVM. So you create, so we are creating a context using builders, context builders. And these context builders are actually configured using the Fluent syntax. So this way we create a builder of a context which will be using the R language. And we also need to tell the context that we need an access to all resources in the GraalVM. So also I have to specify this allow all access with true to instruct that I need access to everything. And running the build method produces an instance of the polyglot context. And then we can start playing with it. So just calling an eval method, it usually takes two arguments. The first argument specifies the language, and the second argument, it specifies the expression I want to evaluate. And the result is an object, which is an instance of the value class, And the value class is a representation of a polyglot object, which can be accessed by a set of methods. And these methods are language agnostic, so they are not bound to a specific language. So we have methods like sBoolean, which are some conversion methods, or that actually force or cast the value to a specific type. Or we have some inquiry methods, which can give us more information about the nature of the value, like can execute, is it executable, or can instantiate, which is kind of, I think, it works like a factory, I think. Or has members. We can also ask if the object has some member bearing, some identifier, and so on and so on. So for example, here we are using the getArraySize method, which obviously just returns the length of the array. So we actually we assert or we expect that this expression returns an array-like value. And using the getArray element is obviously used for retrieving an element from the ith position. And then we convert the value obtained by this method to a double number. Okay, and this is a more complex example, and it illustrates how we can create some structured data in R, and then take this data to Java and work with this more complex data in Java. So the list function is in R used for creating a structure or a structured data. So now in this case we create a structure having three fields, ID, text, and array, and we initialize the values of these fields this way. So by evaluating this script, I get some result. And when I ask the result, do you have some members? I assert that it must return true. Yeah. Then I will just ask for the ID, for the value associated with the ID field, and I will convert it to integer. And it must be 42. Similarly, I ask for the text field and for the array member. And one important thing, you can also use interface as a representation of the structured data. For example, if I create this interface having three abstract methods, ID, text, array, so it fits to this structure perfectly. So when I take this result, I can call the S function or S method on it, result.s, and pass the class of this interface. And it returns an implementation of my struct, which actually wraps the data actually being specified here. So it's a quite an elegant way how to work with polyglot values. And this is the opposite example. I create an object in Java. So I have this my class, and I create an object from an instance of this class, and I pass this object to some R code, which is here. So now I'm using this polyglot bindings, which is an important thing. By polyglot bindings, I can share symbols across languages. So for example, it is like a global hash map of values, and those values are available to every language in the GraalVM. But in order to use that symbol being which was registered by this polyglot bindings put member, you need to explicitly say that you want to work with that symbol. So in R, so every polyglot language has its own polyglot API for working with other languages. So in FastR, you will just use this import function, and you will specify the name of the symbol, and this symbol is then available in this Java object variable. And you can inquire this Java object using these dollar symbols, which are just the member accessors. So Java objects dollar ID just returns the ID value of this structure. So in this case, 42. Tak, so, when you have spent some time programming with the polyglot API, you will quickly find yourself in creating various helpers and auxiliary classes. And this is actually a tax, some disadvantage, but it is inherited in the general nature of the polyglot API. So, in order to overcome that inconvenience, I created the FastR J helper, which is actually a layer which sits between the R code and your application, but the aim is to alleviate from this repetitive actions like creating auxiliary classes and helpers, various helpers. So you can download or check out that FastR J helper from this address, from this GitHub repository. And so this is just the basic usage of that of the FastRJ helper. So using is pretty straightforward. You will just create a new instance of FastR that creates the most permissive polyglot context inside. You can also reuse other context and use another constructor and pass the context into the context. But this one, it is just for the demonstrating purposes to show that it is really simple. And you will just, you can play with it, for example, by executing some R function. So here we execute the runif, the random generator, and passing the argument telling how many random numbers should be generated. There is a similar method called call, which actually does the same thing, but in contrast to the execute method, the call method allows you to specify the arguments by name. Because the R language is infamous for its very complicated system of formal arguments. So you can, for example, write a function that with 10, and it is not something exceptional. You have, for example, in ggplot, which is a graphical library, you can have a function having 10 or more parameters. And in order to make some sense to these parameters, you should name those parameters when executing the function. And there is also some intricacy, because some of those parameters have default values. So for example, if you see some execution of such a function with ten or more arguments, without using names, you wouldn't know what's going on there. So because there are some rules which say the evaluation order of the parameters, but they are too complicated to remember. So instead of remembering these rules, you should name the parameters to make clear what's your intention. Yes, and this is an illustration how the output of an R value looks like in on console. So by executing the print function and passing the object returned by this matrix function, matrix is just a helper function for creating matrices. So if you print this matrix, you will get this output, which is kind of a nice matrix representation. But we'll get the same output, because the two-string implementation of R values uses actually the logic of the print, of the default print function in R. Okay, this is another example of using a Java object in FastR. So this is just the user class having three fields, ID name and favorite language, And there is also some method which just decorates the string being passed to the display name and adding the name of this object. So there are four examples of executing of printing some data, some user objects. So the most, like the simplest one is this one. We just invoke the print function and pass a new instance of the user class. Then when we want to print just the name of the user, we can create this anonymous function with the user, with the single argument user, which will get the object, this user object. And we can use this door accessor to access the name attribute. And but there is a syntax sugar for it, because it requires, it's a kind of needless boilerplate. So there is also some syntax sugar which can use, but this syntax sugar is not part of the R language. It is actually implemented in that FastR helper. Yeah. So you can just write an expression without, so you are not writing any function. You just write an expression, and any symbol which is wrapped into this underscores is interpreted as a formal argument. So using the S function method, you will get a function. And the body of this function is this one, which actually is the expression itself. And this function has a single argument, the user. Yes. Okay, so now I'm coming to the most important part of this slideshow, and it is packages. It is R packages. So how to install a package into your FastR application. It's very, very easy. You will just invoke the install package method and specify the name of the package. That's all. And also you can, but often when you run a package, you and it should, and that is the application using some package may be run in an environment where your package is not installed yet. So you can use this require method to determine whether the package is there or is not. So it return the require method returns a boolean value indicating is it installed or it's not installed. So if it's not installed, I will install, in this case, the package JSON-lite. Okay, and how do I use the package? So the require method not only determines whether the package is installed or not, but it also loads the package. So once you call the require with JSON, from that moment, the JSON-lite functionality is available. So JSON-lite exports, for example, the two JSON function, which obviously converts an object which is passed to this function as the single argument and converts it to a JSON format. So this way, I'm going to convert this 10, these 10 random numbers to a JSON array. So the first line of this output is the result of this system out print null. And similarly, I can also pass a Java integer array. But in this case, I cannot use the array by itself. I have to use this as integer conversion method, which makes an R array or R vector from this Java integer array. Also, I can pass some Java object, but and print the JSON string representing that Java object. In this case, this is the user with those three values. But now I'm using the as-list conversion method, which converts the Java object into a list, which I, as I mentioned before, the list is a common structure used for structured data. Okay, so now I'm coming to the deep layer package. Deepr package, it is one of the most popular packages in FastR, or in FastR, in R in general, because it is the official description of the package is that it is a flexible grammar of data manipulation. So, and this is an example how it works. Empty cars is it's a data set which is used for demonstration. I can, it's just a list of cars and with various attributes like miles per gallon, number of valves and so on. And so I will show a sample of the data of the empty cars in order to have some clue what's going on there. Yes, it's there. So. So this is just a data set containing like a number of various cars with columns like miles per gallon, number of cylinders, displacement, and so on, so on. And you can play with it. For example, if you want to learn the deprecated package, it is the ideal beginning or the starting point where to start learning deprecated. So, how to use deprecated in Java? It's also pretty straightforward. You will just call the require method and specify the deprecated, the name of the package, and then using the eval method of the FastR object, you can pass the source code of the query. So, I can run the query on the command line. What is that? Oh. If I find it. Okay. Okay, yeah. Yo. What's wrong with you? Oh, yeah, because I forgot my glasses, so I can't write it properly. Okay, so deprecated is loading, it's being loaded. And I will run the query again. Okay, so this is the result of the of this query. So this query is quite simple. It just say group this table by the number of cylinders, and then summarize the number of rows in each group. Yeah, so there are actually only three groups with four cylinders, six cylinders, and eight cylinders. And also I have, of course, I can run the same query in Java. So this is actually the same query I've just run on the command line. So the result is some polyglot value, and they, I would like to print individual rows. So to do that, I'm using this s rows utility function, which makes an illusion that the data are actually arranged in rows, because FastR in R the data tables are arranged in columns. So it is somehow quite difficult or clumsy to print rows using the columns. Yeah? So this S rows just make an impression that you are working with rows, not with columns. Okay, so, but you can also parameterize the queries. So, and I've already shown the usage of this formal parameters introduced by expressions. So I can, for example, add another step to the query and filtering out all cars having miles per gallon less than or equal than the specified MPG parameter. So also I'm using the S function, which converts this parameterized query into a function, and I will just empty cars sale Q value, I will call the execute method on it and pass the single parameter, the single MPG parameter. And the result empty car still should be the same as the one I showed on the command line. Sometimes maintaining complicated or complex queries in Java code can be burdensome and can be clumsy. So it is sometimes beneficial to offload those complex queries from the Java code into an R into so-called R bundles. R bundles are just regular R scripts or R files with some R code, and you can put all your R code into those bundles. And then there is a R bundle class which can be used to work with that bundle, with this offloaded code. Yeah. So in this case, I create a new bundle, R bundle, specifying the FastR instance, and also the file pointing to the bundle file. Then I can call the build query method on the bundle and specify the name of the variable initialized in the bundle, and this build query method creates a deep layer query from it. So then I just take this empty cars. And we can also build a deep layer.
So it's fascinating, but we're slightly struggling with time. So do you think like 10 minutes?
Yes, I should fit in 10 minutes.
Thank you.
So you can create a new query by creating an instance of deep layer, and deep layer is just just another layer above the fast R, which represents, which accumulates all necessary logic needed to work conveniently with deep layer. So I create a new query builder, and then I specify all necessary steps to create the query. So group by, summarize, and the build method, it just creates the query. And I'm just executing the query. Mtcars, it's a default data set which is available. It is bundled in the R language. It is available. It's for people who are starting to work with R and they want to have some data set to play with, so they use it as just like starting up or warming up data.
Otherwise, you will have to.
Yeah. Otherwise,
you can create a parameter from it.
Yes.
And if you create a parameter, you can pass the data set in the execute method. And we can also specify a custom Java filter. So it is kind of fancy thing, because you can have some complicated Java logic, which is now it is behind this is allowed MPG, which is a nonsense, but you can imagine that there is some complicated logic saying which car should be included and which should be excluded from the calculation. So I can register a custom Java filter using this assign filter method or builder method on the deep layer query builder. I have to name it, I have to give it some name, and then I will just specify the filter by means of a Java closure. So it's very simple. And then when I use this filter step, I can use this name of that, the name of the filter in the query. And so this filter, it has this a single argument, MPG, and this MPG must be passed because you must specify what is going to be filtered, or by which the query will be filtered. Okay, so now it's time to become a polyglot. I cannot go into details because of the lack of time, but Jarda already was dealing with this stuff. So actually the goal of this slide is to present a very simple Node.js application that just presents some data downloaded from internet. And in this case, the data comes from the Brexit petition called Revoke Article 50 JSON dataset. And the goal is to show the first N cantons or constituency signatures. Yeah. So, and there is only one parameter to this presentation, it is number of columns. So I'm not going to talk about the express, but only I will focus on these three places, which are actually the connecting points with the GraalVM. Yes. So Java type, it is a function used for getting the class of the name of the class being passed as the parameter. Yeah. So Brexit handler, actually it should be called Brexit handler class. You know, so it holds the class of this handler. Actually this handler will be responsible for creating the output. So actually there is no logic, you don't see any logic which could be somehow related to this output. All the output is generated in this Brexit handler, yes. This piece of code is responsible for reacting to a request. So we bind the request handler to this URL, to Brexit, and the first line in the body, it just gets the handler. It is done in such a way that there is only a single handler per request. So you do not allocate more handlers for the same context, which is associated with the thread responsible for handling the request. And this is just specifying the output content type. And this plot chart method being called on the handler is responsible for creating an SVG code, which is displayed here on the page.
So getHandler is a static method of the class.
Which one?
GetHandler.
GetHandler is a static. I will show you shortly what's that. So it is the static member. But plot chart is an instance method. It's instance method. This is how the handler looks. Yes. So this is a simple Java class, and this is the static member, which creates an instance of Brexit handler class. But using this complicated chain of commands, it guarantees that there is only one instance of Brexit handler associated with a given thread. So it is actually per thread allocation. Yes. Then the plot chart instance method is responsible for generating the SVG output. So it's also kind of very simple here, because we just take some data. So plot this field, plot head data function, it is initialized in the constructor of Brexit handler. So this is a function which is responsible for retrieving the data to be displayed. And this data are in turn passed to the plot function. A plot function, it is a function which I will show on the next slide. And it is just a function which takes some data table, and this data table is converted into a ggplot. Ggplot is a graphical library, very popular in the R world, and it produces the SVG representation of the data of the plot. And the function returns a polyglot value, the out variable, but we have to normal string. The first thing we need to initialize the function for retrieving the data. Or a, diff, which is a common R function, which just takes the head of some table. You specify how many numbers you want to take from the data table. So we will be showing, as I said, we will be showing only two or three or more columns, and the number of columns is actually the parameter. This N parameter is it actually specifies the number of columns we want to be displayed. Yeah. So this is the data function, and then we initialize the R bundle being used by this request handler, and we take two things from the bundle. The SVG example, it is actually the plot function. I should have, I think, named it in a different way, but but it's done, so I can't do it with it, no, nothing else. So the plot function is responsible for creating the SVG output. And the plot data, it is actually the data retrieved from the Brexit petition site, the big JSON file.
So
this is the last slide. So this is the bundle, and just a note, notice that I also mention the dependencies here. So I need to work with JSONLite, I need to work with dplyr, I need to work with ggplot. And this stuff, it is just an R code responsible for creating the SVG representation and for downloading the data from the petition site and for getting the table with signatures from this JSON file. And can I just run the application to show how it looks?
Sure.
Yeah, because I think it's like the last thing I would like to show.
Yeah, before Zbyněk gets set, there probably won't be space for Q&A, but we share contacts with all our speakers today, so you can send them questions afterwards. There's one more short talk to go through, and that would be it for the night. Also, I forgot to mention when I gave the introduction where actually the bathrooms are, so sorry, apologies for that. So it's in the very back on the right-hand side. Thanks.
So just so I've just started the Node.js, and I specified the path to the server.js file, which contains the application. And now it's ready. It's listening on that port 12836. So I can just try it from the browser. And what's going on here? Still nothing. Because now there is a lot of initialization here. So the fast R must be initialized. Must be loaded. Loading. So I think it's still being loaded. Yes. So it takes a while, but in a subsequent call, in subsequent calls, the response time is obviously much, much better. So now this is the result. I can change the number of columns for 5. Okay, 5. And last thing, and the very last thing, there is another example showing, it's just here to demonstrate another library called Niter, which can convert a complex data set into a nice looking HTML table. Oh. And this is the variant of my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Zbyněk. I should also mention that Zbyněk forgot his glasses today, so it's really great.
It was quite difficult for him.
It was quite difficult for him to read all the text and give you all the demos, so I would say that deserves additional a round of applause. Okay, so we're slightly behind the schedule, and so let's have a very short break before our next speaker, final speaker, gets set. Okay?
FastR is an integration with Spark.
It can work. It can work with Spark.
Scientists, right?
Yes.
Data science and most data science here is Spark,
yes.
But only Python, and sometimes they could use this very nice query language.
It can be used in the same as, for example, as like link you, yeah. Link in yeah. C sharp. Yes.
It's very nice, by the way.
To jako
organizuje,
že si ty slidy
budou. Budou, budou dostupné. The slides will be available right after the...
It'll be in a few days, it'll be online and everything.
Pak jsem se chtěl zeptat toho, co to je jako to FastR, to Graal, tak to běží jako na nějakém serveru, že tam ze spodu bylo napsané jako Node.js a zhora byly jako Java nebo a JavaScript.
No, to FastR, no, libovolný jazyk, který tam je jako zmíněný, tak ten může běžet buď samostatně, jo, jako třeba R konzole, anebo může být právě, může běžet v různých kontextech. Jinak to kontextu je třeba JVM samo o sobě, JDK. A nebo databáze to může být, nebo to může být Node.js,
takže
oni si
vypůjčují kódy skrz ten kontext?
Jo. Ano.
A to překládá ten Graal?
Ano, ten Graal, ono se to nejdřív interpretuje, že jo? To jsou všechno interpretované jazyky. A to okamžiku, kdy ten interpretovaný kód se zahřeje, tak se z něho vlastně vygeneruje machine code. Vlastně jako just-in-time compiler, že jo? Ten Graal compiler začne kompilovat ten interpretovaný kód a vyplivne z něj machine code. V podstatě ten, jako to, co dělá normální native, ten just-in-time compiler.
A mě tam jako nebylo jasný to, že třeba vytvořená matice a teďka jako kde je jako ta matice, že naraz to použil v Javě a použil jste na to i R-kový příkaz a teďka to bylo to, že jako jak to mám představit.
Pizza is arriving in about 10 minutes.
So, hello everybody, I am Jenda, here from...
So I was about to introduce Jenda, but there's no need. Let's don't waste any more time and let's give the stage to Jenda, our fellow Avastian. Thank you.
once again, Hello, everybody. I am Jenda here from Avast. I am a scholar developer here in Threat Labs. And don't worry, my talk will be much, much lighter and shorter than the previous ones. And there will be pizza after that. Okay. I am here today to show you how we use RabbitMQ and in Avast, and how can you benefit from that. Avast is a department them and save all this. Then we evaluate whether those metadata looks like the file suspicious. If it doesn't look so, we're happy. If it looks so, we do detailed analysis, either manually by our malware analysts team, or preferably by some machine. We use machine learning, etc. But that's another story for another talk. From the detailed analysis, we create new detection to prevent that the bug, the problem we actually found in the file will reappear in some other file. And then we publish new detection to you, and that makes you happy. At least we hope so. For the RabbitMQ, who of you use RabbitMQ on a regular basis in your work? Nice. Who, on the other hand, didn't hear about RabbitMQ or doesn't know how it works? Few ones, right? So very quickly, because we don't have much time, RabbitMQ is a shortcut for Rabbit Message Queue. It means some fast message queuing. There is a producer and consumer. Producers send messages to consumers, and it's done through an exchange. Oh, it's very hard to. it's done through exchange, which has several types, and based on the type, the exchange routes messages based on bindings to several queues. And those messages are read by consumers from the queues. Exchange can route one message to multiple queues. Queues can have multiple consumers, so they share the same data. But of course, every message has to be delivered only to one consumer, so there is no duplicity of data. Yeah, that's a very short introduction. Now, how we use Rabbits in Threat Labs. Our backends are event-driven. That means they sit on the RabbitMQ queues and wait until something happens. We have RabbitMQ cluster. Well, we have many clusters in Avast, but the Threat Labs has its own cluster. In that cluster, there are four nodes. Those four nodes use together about 12 gigabytes of RAM. There are about 50 exchanges and 190 queues. But we mainly use only one single exchange from those 50. That's because it's an exchange where basically all events from our system goes, and every application that's interested in some kind of event just subscribes for that kind of event. On traffic, approximately 10,000 messages going out. Yeah, it's real. I'll explain it later. And there are about 30 different events going through the exchange. Just for information, those most wanted by our microservices events are that the file was scanned and its result may have changed. And the second most popular is that file was actually added to our system, and we now know some basic metadata about them. Next, I will show you examples of three microservices that are working this way. The first is best of all classifier, which is a classification based on those let's say, static metadata. It reacts on the events that file was edited, file was scanned, and every time something happens with file, the classification is recalculated, saved into database, and anyone can ask, hey, what do you think the single result about this file? Result can be malware, advar, clean, and some other types. Another example is scans. That's application that provides on-demand scanning. You just say, hey, I want to scan this file with this scanner, and it will do the job and publish event, file scanned with old result, new result, and everyone that's interested in the event will actually get it. The last example is unpack service, because we see many files every day, and all of them are actually archive. So we're much interested in the files that are actually in the archive, so we have to unpack it. So unpack service is a service that gets file edit event, and when it detects the file is zip, jar, or some other archive tab, it downloads the file, it unpacks it, and adds those specific files from inside the archive to our system, and then they are processed like any other file. Yeah, second part of my talk is introduction of our own RabbitMQ client. It's mostly suitable for Scala, but it also has some Java API, even though it's not that rich as the Scala one. Let's start with why we even decided to have our own RabbitMQ client. Originally, we used the official one, but if you ever try to use it, the official client from Pivotal is kind of a low level. Yeah, you can do anything with that. When you try to do it, you have to write a lot of code, and you have a boilerplate which you copies between specific applications. So what you will do next? You will write some utility library, maybe, or you can write your own abstraction on top of this official client, which is exactly what we did. Now, why we think our abstraction is better? Our abstraction provides declarative configuration in a Hokon format, which means the configuration is clear for both programmers and know how the client is configured and across different deployment environments. Our abstraction provides declarative Scala first API, which is now finally tagless. And yeah, this is very important point, because official docs contains many recommendations and best practices, but you have to write them by your own. For example, prefetch count, it means how many messages should be buffered by your client when you're consuming messages. The default with the official client is zero, which is unlimited. So basically, a single instance of your application can buffer all messages in queue, and other instances will get nothing, even though they are able to process messages. And this is really, really not something that you want. And another thing that you don't want to do is to copy those best practices, again, across all your libraries. So we actually implemented most of best practices inside our abstraction. We kept the producers and consumers concept. So with our client, you create a producer, you will get an instance of class in your hand, which has a send method, and you don't have the underlying channel in your hand, which is somewhere in your code, right? And you can be sure that the channel is exclusive just for the producer, and you don't have a channel that's used by some other component in your application. That's what we want. And the consumer, it's the same. It's abstraction over the consumers that are already present in the official client, but it's much better. Additionally, it supports automatic declaration. Consumer needs a queue. And what if the queue does not exist? So again, it's best practice if the consumer can actually create the queue he needs for his work and even bind his queue to some exchange with specified routing key. And that's everything described in declaration way in the configuration. Our client has built-in metrics and logging, which is kind of useful if you think your application behaves strange and you need to see what events are actually coming to the application, then you can easily enable debug logging for the client and see what's on your wire. Another thing is asynchronicity, which enables parallel message processing. You can process up to some amount of events in parallel, which can really speed up your processing. And your messages are delivered already parsed, because again, the official client gives you a raw array of bytes. That's usually not something you want. You want to have JSON, etc., and you have to parse it by your own. With our client, you can just say, hey, try to parse received bytes as JSON or as this case class, and if it fails, do this. If it goes okay, do this. You pass some lambda and it just works. And the last thing, I promise, at least I hope so, I can promise that, is a network recovery. Originally, we relied on the official client, and it was really terrible. When the cluster needed to be restarted, the connection wasn't recovered. So we added a Lyra, which is library for better recovery. And we had this library until the official client version 5 came out. Since the version 5, it works quite nice, and currently we only added exponential backup strategy, so if the recovery is not done immediately, it's retried in exponential backup manner. So this is one of the last slides of my presentation. I have a present for you. The present is that our client is available on GitHub, so you can go check it out, try it, and we'll be glad if you try it, and if you're missing something, let us know, and we'll be glad to implement it. That's everything from me. Thank you. Some questions, anybody?
Any questions?
Why
Douglas final is the question.
Ah, you're trolling, right? Well, originally the client was built on top of futures, Scala futures, of course. But that's kind of the experiences show that the futures are part of the history. So we decided to implement finally Douglas to provide you an option to use CatsEffect.io or Scalamonix task. Now, well, yeah, the ZIO came, but maybe there will be some changes in this manner. currently you have just an option to choose your own app which you work in, and there's also kind of, well, I don't want to call it hack, but there is a way how to turn it back into future, and there is a way how to turn it even to synchronous context with try. Basically, anything that is convertible to and from Monik's task, which is used internally, to be honest.
Any more questions?
Yeah, actually, I was a bit confused by your last sentence when you said that it's actually using Monik's task inside and it's exposing cat's effect type class interface. So did I get it right? Is that how it works?
Yeah, some very it's very minimal part, but there is some specific part inside the client that's implemented in Monik's task, because the IO has very, in my opinion, it is very unfriendly API, and there were some things that needed to be done, and it would require much more effort to implement the same thing in IO. I mean, like retrying, etc., etc. This is something that the task has already implemented. You have it for free, and with IO, you have to do a lot of work to be sure that you're doing it right. Even some basic things like switching the IO between contexts, between executors, it's not very trivial thing. On the other hand, with task, it is. So yeah, it uses tasks internally, and as soon as possible, it's converted to abstract F.
Thank you. So if there are no more questions, then thanks a lot to Jenda for a great presentation.
And thank you.
And your patience is now will be paid off by the awesome pizza we got in the back office, just to the last table. Feel free to help yourself and get good few slices. Thank you, everyone.